All right, now it comes to bullfighters, the bullfighters category, and this is one for the books.
Miles Hare, one of the most athletic bullfighters ever, selected to the National Finals Rodeo 6 times. The bull riders knew the vote, we think, and this guy was there, and he was awesome every time he showed up with the grease paint. He was in the inaugural Wrangler bullfighting exhibitions, and he's the world champion in 1981, and then he shared that title with fellow Hall of Famer Rock Smith in 1988. Testament to their durability, and you know, people say bull riders are crazy. Well, no, the bull fighters are crazy. I mean, you know, we already had them caught, so it wasn't too hard. It was better than team roping. You get on in the chute, then you had to get off. The bull fighters had to go in there and step in there and take them away. And while bull riders never want to think that they rely on bull fighters, I've been on some of Cotton's bulls, and certainly some of my daddy's bulls, that I was glad that guys like Rob Smith, Miles Hare, Jimmy Anderson, I could look out there, and I knew that if I got hooked, they got hooked before I did, and that's all you can do. So it's just one of the the things that goes hand in hand with bull riding, and it's bull fighting. But these guys, they're cowboys.
So where is Rob Smets? I'm gonna have Rob tell, Rob, I'm gonna let you tell a little Miles Hare story, and then we might hear from some bull riders as well. Story, okay, one story at a time.
All right, well, a few things to say. 1977, Miles Hare worked his very first NFR. From 1977 to 2014, when Cody Webster finally went to his first NFR, Miles was the youngest bullfighter to ever work the NFR, and held that for, obviously, several years. Miles learned a bunch from world champion Skipper Voss, sitting right back there in the back also. Miles won the World 81, Skipper won the World 82. Unfortunately, I was a little bit younger, so I gained from Skipper, I learned from Miles, and I got to learn from Wick. In 83, I finally got to win the world championship also. The greatest thing about what we did, we all shared. The first time Miles and I fought bulls together, we were in Monroe, Louisiana, and almost ended up in a fist fight, and shoulders had to ride between us. The next year was the first year we went for Daddy. Worked Fort Worth, and about halfway through it, it was sure nice to be with somebody that was maybe better than you were to go, will you jump in and get us out of here? Because Dad wouldn't open the gate without something getting done. 1988, we got to win. We, at the end of 32 go-rounds, we shared dollar for dollar, penny for penny, and the only time that there was a tie for a world championship. I couldn't share it with a better guy. Miles Hare has 2 world championships, but he's responsible for 7 of them. We worked the NFR on 3 occasions. If a guy's got to go in and come take care of cowboys, you want Miles Hare on the other side. God bless you, Miles Hare.
Come on up here, Miles. While he's coming, Miles can respond. I was at the college national finals one time. I didn't go to college. I was doing the Good Light Beer for Miller commercials with Jim Shoulders, so I was there with Jim Shoulders trying to learn how to drink Miller beer, and watching the rodeo, and they turned out crooked nose. And I'd heard all about, you know, this bull, and everybody wanted to see Miles Hare and crooked nose. And I remember, I don't think I've ever seen anybody get hit in the belly with a horn and go around the horn like a propeller blade on an airplane and get up, until I saw Miles Hare do it in Bozeman, Montana, and then go back to that sunburn. That was the most awesome display, because you went out there knowing that you were going to get hooked, but it was just something for me to watch.
Without them bulls, I mean, I was not a comedian, I wasn't funny. I used to help Well do his car acting. He'd say, you like that fuse, then get out of the way, because the sack's got to be funny. And I'd do just that. But if there's anything that really changed over the years that I can say is the bulls. When I first started working in Houston, I'd walk down the ramp of the Astrodome and there'd be 25 Brindles in the pen in two or three spots. By the time I quit working in Houston 31 years later, I'd walk down that same ramp and there would be 25 spots in the pen in two or three Brindles. And the Brindles is what made me stay alive. They were the most treacherous bulls in the world. The guys like Gracie Chaffee, Ted News, some of the inductees here, Bando's here, they all testified to how dangerous those bulls were. And it gave me a job and job security. And it was so important to me that they had the eliminators out there. I was always honored to get in front of them. I sometimes wasn't always the favorite guy for some of the stock contractors. We were a little bit wild. We spent a little time after the rodeo having a good time. But I'll tell you what, there was nothing more important to me than the bulls that were bucked that night. And not only not to screw one up, to be where he's supposed to be, and not to miss a kick. I admire bullfighters or bull riders a lot because they had the guts to get on those kind of bulls. And I'll tell you what, there's a lot of bulls that jerk you down. Jim Shoulders told me one time, he said, there's bulls, I keep bulls for two reasons, and not all of them is just because they buck. Because some of my bulls that ain't the rankest bulls here sell more tickets than my rankest bulls. And he said, it's very important that we have those kind of bulls out in every performance. And I never complained after that. I always looked up to Shoulders and the bull riders, and I just went along for the ride, and there I am today.
Did y'all hear him say 31 years fought bulls at one rodeo? 31 years, do the math on that.
And then he and, you know, those after hours things, you know, going through the rewrite stories, he was with Jimmy Anderson practicing on how to be funny from Quail's Act. They never got that part down, but I'm gonna tell you, always good to know. Jim Shoulders was a partner with my daddy when they opened the Mesquite Rodeo in 1958. And I remember I've drawn a bull, it's like 1971. I don't think I'd been to the NFR yet. I got a bull called Rodeo Red of my dad's, and ain't nobody rode him yet. He said, well, he's pretty good at this. He's got to bear down. He said, but if you can't ride him, get in underneath him and help me sell some tickets. You know, and I was kind of speechless, but my grandma lit into him. I mean, she wore him out. That was pretty good. So, you know, but we've always had great bullfighters, and welcome to the club. You deserve it.
Thank you so much. I would like to thank my wife, Melinda, my mother for raising me, and all these bull riders in between. It's been a good ride for me, and it's not over. I mean, Smitsy and I still put on a lot of bullfighting schools. I'm headed tonight to run down and judge a bullfight in Gonzales that Shorty Gorham's putting on. And these boys are lucky they're fighting Mexican bulls instead of crossbred bulls, because I can tell you, 1,400 pounds of bad ain't as bad as 2,000 pounds of bad.
All right, we'll get a photo op.